Welcome to this new Inside Code video where we will see the triangle problem, a very interesting problem if you want to understand more about recursion and dynamic programming, so try to stay until the end. Without waiting more, let's jump into it. What does the problem say? It says, given a triangle represented by a 2D array, create a function that returns the minimum path sum to go from the top to bottom. For example, if we have this triangle, the minimum path sum is 15, which we can get by taking this particular path. To better understand, let me give you some clarifications. First thing, what is a path? A path is the set of cells we pass through to go from top to bottom. In other words, from the first row to the last row, knowing that each move consists of going to one of the adjacent cells on the row below. Second thing, the triangles are represented in memory by a 2D array. For example, this triangle is represented like this, so it's not really a triangle, it's more like stairs. The last thing to know is that when being on the cell triangle of IG, we can move to triangle of I plus 1G and triangle of I plus 1G plus 1 only. Okay, now we can start solving. And the intuitive solution some of you probably got is to be greedy, to always choose the smaller value between the two edges and cells to get the minimum path sum. By applying it to this triangle, we'd start at 2, then 1 is smaller than 4 so we go to the left, and then 3 is smaller than 19 so we go to the left, then 10 is smaller than 12 so we go to the right, and then 8 is smaller than 11 so we go to the right, and the total is 24. But the problem is that it's not the minimum path sum, because we can't find 15 by taking this one, which means that this method doesn't always work. In other words, always going to the smaller adjacent cell doesn't guarantee to find the minimum path sum, so the solution is not valid. This solution is not valid because considering that an adjacent cell is smaller than the other, we assume that it's the one that will lead us to the minimum path sum, which is not always the case as we've seen now. Which means that when being on a cell, we can't directly know which move will give us the minimum path sum, so what we can do is to try them both and take the minimum among them, to whom we add the value of the actual cell. But again here, to get the min sum from a cell, we have to do the same process with its adjacent cells, we deduce that it's a recursive process. What's gonna happen is that, to get the min sum from top to bottom, we first need to get the min sum from its adjacent cells, let's start with the left one. Same thing again here, we first need the min sum from the adjacent cells, we start with the left one, and same thing again because we didn't reach the base case yet. So we go to the left and same thing again. But here when we go to the left, we reach the base case because we are already on the last row, so we just need to return the value of the actual cell, which is 7. We backtrack to this cell and we get the min sum when we go to the right now, and is the base case, so we get 11. Now that we have both, we return 12, which is the value of the actual cell, plus the minimum between 7 and 11, which is 7, so the total is 19. Now we backtrack to this cell, and we need to get the min sum from the right, and it's the same process, from the left, base case, it returns 11, from the right, base case, it returns 8, the min is 8, so we return 10 plus 8, which is 18. Back to this cell, we have 19 from the left and 18 from the right, so we return 18 plus 3, which is 21. And the recursive process continues like this until we get the minimum path sum, which is 15. For the code of the solution, we need the recursive function that takes as parameters the triangle and I and g, which are the coordinates of the actual cell. And because we start at the first cell of the first row, which is triangle of 0, 0, then their initial value is 0. Now we have the base case, we said that it's when we are on the last row, in other words, when I is at the index length of triangle minus 1. In that case, we said that we just return the value of that cell, which is triangle of IG. Else, we have the recursive case, where we return triangle of IG plus the minimum between the min sum from triangle of I plus 1G that we can get by calling the same function but with I plus 1 and G as parameters, and the min sum from triangle of I plus 1 G plus 1 that we can get by calling the same function but with I plus 1 and G plus 1 as parameters. That's it. For the time complexity of this function, you can see that in the recursive case, we are always calling the function again twice, and we are always moving to the next row, so because we have n rows, then we will have 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 n times, which is 2 power n. This is why we get a time complexity of O of 2 power n. And for the space complexity, the function doesn't use extra space, but it's a non-tail recursive function, so we need to consider the call stack. Here the call stack is holding one call for each row, and we said that we have n rows, so the maximum call stack size is n. That situation happens when we are at the bottom of the recursion tree. This is why we get a space complexity of O of n. Unlike the greedy solution, the recursive solution works, but the problem is that it has an exponential time complexity, which is inefficient for this problem. And the reason behind it is that if we have a look at the recursion tree, we find a lot of repeated recursive calls, so we are doing the same work again and again uselessly. This is why, to optimize the recursive solution, we just have to find a way to avoid repeating the same work. And one possible way is to use dynamic programming. But before jumping into it, please pause the video and subscribe to the channel and activate the bell to not miss the incoming videos. With dynamic programming, we will use a 2D array DP of the same size as triangle, where DP of IG represents the minimum sum to go from triangle of IG to the last row. And we keep getting values from the previous row that we filled, until we reach the first row that has only one cell and it represents the minimum path sum we're searching for, we return it. This process is the main idea of dynamic programming, setting the base case, then always getting the next value from the previous one until we reach the one we're searching for. Let's go deep into the dynamic programming process for this particular problem so that you can understand how the 2D array DP got filled cell by cell. Here is our empty DP2D array, and as said earlier, we first need to set the base case. And it's the same as for the recursive solution, it's where we are on the last row, because the value is just equal to triangle of IG. So here we have 7, then 11, then 8, then 1, and then 4. And now we move to the row above, where we can start getting values by using the row we filled now. So pause the video and try to find the relation between them. A little hint to help you, check the recursive function we made. In reality, the relation is the same as the one in recursion, where min path sum from the cell in IG is triangle of IG plus the minimum between min path sum from the cell in I plus 1G and min path sum from the cell in I plus 1G plus 1. It's just that in dynamic programming, we are dealing with a 2D array, and not with function calls, so we write DP of IG is equal to triangle of IG plus the min between DP of I plus 1G and DP of I plus 1G plus 1. Now that we have the relation, we can continue filling DP. For this cell, the min between DP of I plus 1G and DP of I plus 1G plus 1 is 7, plus 12 we get 19. Then for this one, it's 10 plus 8, 18. Then this one, 3 plus 1, 4. Last cell, 9 plus 1, 10. We finished filling this row and we'll follow the same logic for the one above. Here we have 3 plus 18, 21, then 19 plus 4, 23, then 5 plus 4, 9. The one above, same thing, we have 1 plus 21, which is 22, then 4 plus 9, which is 13. Now we arrived at the cell of the first row, the one we're searching for, and it's 2 plus 13, which is 15, so the minimum path sum is 15, the same result we found with the previous method. Okay, but now you may tell me, we follow the same logic as recursion, then why is this solution better? The answer is that, unlike recursion, here we didn't repeat the same work uselessly, because when we calculated the value of this cell for example, we could use it to calculate this cell and also this one, without having to recalculate it like for recursion. So this is the main difference between both solutions, and this is why dynamic programming is more optimized for this problem. For the code of this solution, the function takes a triangle, then creates a 2D array DP whose size is the same as triangle. Then, if you noticed, we were filling DP starting from the last row, so the initial value of I is the last index of DP, which is length of DP minus 1. Then, we keep looping while I is positive, because the first row is at the index 0. Inside the loop, we need another loop to fill the row. Now, inside the nested loop, we use the same logic as for recursion, but by dealing with DP, so if we are on the last row, DP of IG is just equal to triangle of IG. Else, DP of IG is triangle of IG plus the minimum between DP of I plus 1G and DP of I plus 1G plus 1, as explained earlier. After filling the row, in other words, after the nested loop, we don't forget to decrement I to move to the row above, we'd have an infinite loop otherwise. Now, after filling DP, the value we're initially searching for is at DP of 0, 0, the only cell of the first row, so we return it. Before jumping into time and space complexity analysis, we need to understand how many cells does DP contain. DP has 1 cell on the first row, 2 cells on the second row, 3 cells on the third row, and so on. So the total is 1 plus 2 plus 3 etc. until n, which is the famous Gauss sum that can be expressed by the formula n times n plus 1 divided by 2. Remember this result. Now for the time complexity, in reality we are just filling dp, and dp has n times n plus 1 divided by 2 cells. But we can simplify to remove smaller terms. N times n plus 1 divided by 2 is equal to n squared plus n divided by 2, which is 1 half n squared plus 1 half n. We remove the smaller terms, we remove the constant, and we get a time complexity of n squared. Same logic for the space complexity. We need extra space for creating dp that has n times n plus 1 divided by 2 cells, which can be simplified to n squared, so the space complexity is of n squared. And you can see that we could use dynamic programming to get a better time complexity than for recursion. We got a solution in polynomial time now. But this solution also has a con, is the of n squared space complexity, and we can optimize it. But how? We can optimize it because if you noticed, we always need the actual row and the previous one only. So the idea is that instead of creating a whole new 2D array, we just play with two rows, the actual one and the previous one. To better understand, let's get the value we're searching for, but by using two rows only, by starting from the bottom as we did. The last row is easy to fill, we just put values of the last row of triangle. Now for the level above, pref dp, which represents the previous row, becomes equal to dp, and dp becomes a new empty row. Remember, here we have 12 plus 7, 19, then 18, then 4, then 10. And now, same manipulation, pref dp becomes dp, and dp becomes a new empty row, and you can see that we are decrementing the size each time. Here we have 21, then 23, then 9 if you remember. Same process again, pref dp becomes equal to dp, and dp becomes a new empty row. We fill dp, we get 22 and 13. Pref dp becomes equal to dp, and dp becomes a new empty row. Now dp will have 15, then pref dp becomes dp, and dp becomes a new empty row. But now, I became negative. So the loop stops, and you can see that the value we were searching for is in pref dp, so we could get the same result, but by using two arrays only instead of a whole 2D array. To implement this solution, we just take the same code we used for the classic dynamic programming solution, and we modify a few things. First of all, dp is no more a 2D array, but just a simple array of size n where n is the number of rows. Second thing, you need to understand that in the classic solution we were always dealing with rows dp of I and dp of I plus 1. They represent the actual row and the previous row respectively. And now we are using dp and pref dp, so we replace all instances of dp of I by dp and all instances of dp of I plus 1 by pref dp. So now in the general case, dp of g is triangle of ig plus the minimum between pref dp of g and pref dp of g plus 1. Third thing, before looping again, we need to do that manipulation. So pref dp becomes dp, then we said that we decrement the size, so the new size is length of dp minus 1, and dp becomes a new array of that size. And last difference, remember that at the end, the value we are searching for is the first and only cell of pref dp, so we return pref dp of 0. And because now we need extra space for only 2 rows of at most n elements, then the extra space is 2n, which can be reduced to an O of n space complexity by removing the constant. In Braille, for this problem, we've seen 3 valid solutions, the recursive solution, O of 2 power n time complexity and O of n space complexity, then the dynamic programming solution, then the dynamic programming solution, O of n squared time complexity and O of n squared space complexity, and then this one, the space optimized dynamic programming solution, O of n squared time complexity and O of n space complexity. This problem was an interesting one to see how dynamic programming works. I hope that you understood the process, ask me in comments if you didn't, and if you want more explained dynamic programming related problems, you can get the 50 popular coding interview course. It contains a lot of DP problems like longest common subsequence, ways to climb stairs, coin change, and many other ones. A very interesting course if you want to improve your skills in problem solving, algorithms, data structures, and time and space complexity analysis. So if you enjoyed this video and the way I explain solutions, then you should really have a look at it. The link is in the description, where you will also find the code for the solutions we've seen. Now please leave a like, subscribe to the channel, share this video with other people, and see you in the next one.